Hi, it's Giffen Lebates here, and today I want to talk specifically about proof of stake. Proof of stake is an alternative to proof of work, and the reason why a lot of people are putting it forward as a good consensus protocol for blockchains is because it doesn't consume the vast quantities of energy that proof of work does. Now, proof of work has proved itself. It works brilliantly as a mechanism to ensure that a blockchain is truly decentralized, that a blockchain does indeed randomly select who gets to make the next block containing the transactions, thereby making sure that lots of different participants on the blockchain are selecting transactions, packaging them and putting them on the blockchain. And that results in censorship resistance, and it results in it becoming virtually impossible for anybody to rewrite history and therefore conduct a double spend attack. Proof of stake is different. In proof of stake, participants on the blockchain take their assets on the blockchain and they lock them up. And by locking them up, they get the right to participate in the selection of the next person who gets to add a block and therefore gets the block reward. And the block reward acts as an incentive to make sure that people are honest in proof of work, and it does a similar kind of thing in proof of stake. However, proof of stake does have some problems, and the problem that is the most foremost is the nothing at stake issue. The fact is that in proof of work, you have this limited resource, the amount of work that you can do based on the amount of hardware you've purchased and the amount of energy that you're willing to burn in order to participate in the game. And there is a finite amount of energy, there's a finite amount of hardware, and as a result, proof of work miners have a lot of skin in the game when it comes to maintaining and extending a proof of work blockchain. In proof of stake, because there's no real cost associated with participating in the blockchain maintenance and extension process, proof of stakers can effectively sign as many blocks as they like. And this means that when a fork occurs, they will just sign everything on every chain because it increases their odds of being the person who signs the block that becomes canonical, and therefore they get the block reward. And in fact, it's worse than that because proof of stake allows large stakeholders to actually create their own parallel chains unbeknownst to the rest of the network and then reveal them later on, thereby snaffling up all the rewards, or even worse, conducting a double spend attack. Now, there are various mechanisms that are put forward to overcome this. One of them is to have a system whereby you apply a penalty if somebody signs more than one chain. So you're asking people to commit to only participating on one chain. But there is a problem with this in that if you sign two chains, then if you control one of those chains and that becomes the canonical one, you can refuse to sign the block that imposes a penalty on you for signing the other chain. So again, large stakeholders have an advantage over the small stakeholders, and they can use that to manipulate how the system works. The other problem that proof of stake has is that whereas with proof of work there is the closest thing to an objective measure as to whether or not a particular chain is the canonical one, namely the total amount of work that's been put into it, the chain with the most work is the true one. In proof of stake, you have no way of distinguishing between the relative importance of the different chains. They all look the same to an outside observer, and most proof of stake systems get around this by a rather cheap trick, which is to say every so many blocks, say every 728 or every 1,000 or whatever, we'll checkmark this on a public site such as a website or a server, and we'll just all agree with each other that this is the canonical block, rather the canonical chain. And that kind of defeats the whole point of proof of work, which is that in proof of work, an alien could come down from outer space, look at all the chains and immediately decide that's the one that is the true one. In proof of stake, if somebody comes in from the outside like that and has to decide which of the chains is the correct one, there is no objective way of doing that other than going to what is effectively a centralized location that says this is the true chain. At which point you might as well say, well, let's just use a database and a group of people who we trust. And indeed, this is often what happens in proof of stake. They are often controlled by a very small number of parties, and we just have to go with that. Now, you can point at lots of proof of stake blockchains and say, these are working, that's fine. But the problem there is that they have worked in hindsight. And what we want with a proof of stake or proof of work blockchain is for it to work in the future. And you can look at past performance and use it as a predictor of future performance. But of course, that's not good enough when it comes to a true decentralized system where we need to know that through cryptography and mathematics, as long as something like a 51% attack, for example, as could occur in Bitcoin, but probably won't because of economic reasons, as long as that doesn't happen, the chain will continue to be canonical and we will be able to decide that's the right chain. In proof of stake, you can look at the past of a particular proof of stake chain and say, yeah, this one's fine. It's run really, really well, but there's no guarantee that tomorrow there won't be some form of collusion or corruption that does wipe out the whole purpose of the thing in the first place. So I haven't seen any brilliant solutions to this problem, and I imagine that people are still working on it. I don't know if it's actually an intractable problem. But anyway, that's proof of stake, and that's my concerns surrounding it. Hope you found that interesting, and I'll see you in the next video soon. Bye for now.